Space, a timeless infinity of emptiness, filled with the teeming galaxies and planets of countless people. Into this vast area of space come Mike and Ken of Star Command. Asteroid fields of Arborus, cold, dark, lonely. Suspended debris floating endlessly in the foreboding presence of the Arborus double black hole. Yet within the heart of a small planetoid in this asteroid field lives a small city made of refugees and the remnants of Star Command, hiding from a cancer of evil. With the galaxy now firmly in the hands of Baman and Echion, only a handful were left who held on to their freedom. Such was a small group of valiant resistance fighters from Pleiades, who sat soberly in a crowded briefing room as instructions were given in what was to be the start of the most incredible battle in galactic history. The feeling was one of hopelessness. The flight crew sat in stony silence as they listened to new information from the outside. General Mhyrn Lucian wearily stepped to the podium. She looked over the men assembled and spoke.
I don't need to tell you about this mission. In all the history of our hit-and-run guerrilla attacks on the Empire, none will be more important and more potentially costly than this one. Our target is the planet Artis 5. This planet makes all the core fittings for Echion's portal generators. If we can destroy that plant, you know what it'll do to his plans. Without core fittings, he can't transmit, and we've bought a little more time for the Federation. Now, no doubt some of you question a maximum effort when we're so short of manpower and Falcons. But what I will tell you now is strictly classified. It is not to be discussed outside of this briefing area. Probe droids and intelligence have discovered that Echion has now sealed off access to the Magellanic Deep Space Array. We suspect Echion has succeeded in building a transgalactic portal. If that is true, then he is planning to expand his terror, and we must stop him. Major Davis.
General, with Echion hoping to open a transgalactic portal, doesn't that lend credence to the Ships of Light theory?
Well, it might. But so far, the account of the Ships of Light disappearing into Arborus 1 is sketchy. We know that Colonel Ken Fox, in fact, escaped from Terron after the Verbeel tank first attacked us, and all we know of Mike Fox is that he escaped the hospital ship and vanished. We don't know whether there's any connection between those two and the Ships of Light. I'm aware of the stories concerning the ships and the Fox brothers, but we've heard nothing from them in 3 years. And so we must assume that they're missing in action, presumed dead. As far as Echion and his portal network are concerned, we have to stop it or slow it down. Hopefully, this mission will accomplish that. Now, Major Reeber will bring you up to date on outside conditions.
Major Reeber then painted a bleak and terrifying picture of life under the Dark Empire. Steve Davis sat listening and shook his head. Never had he known such despair. Yet he knew that they must stop Echion in his quest for universal control. He also felt that this mission would be a suicide mission for many of Star Command's tired pilots. But that didn't matter, for they were to try once more to slow Echion. Resolved, he stood and joined the throng, which soon roared away from Pleiades. As the Falcons neared Artis 5, the sight that met them caused considerable alarm.
Saber 5 to 1. Davis, are my scanners jammed or what? I show massive targets just outside Artis' gravitational influence.
Copy, Saber 5. I'm afraid your scanners are okay. I see them too.
Verbeel tanks? Hundreds of them. How did they get so many?
Well, we knew it would be tough. Arm shields and interlock scanners.
Imps of space? I didn't think Baman could build more than one of those things.
He hasn't been on vacation, I guess. Okay, Rapier 1 and 4, begin your diversionary runs in 2 minutes. Broadsword 2 and 3, the plan is on grid coordinate Bravo Delta 27.8. Good hunting. Saber 5, your and my groups will have a straight-in run. See you sometime, Dave.
Yeah, someday. Good hunting, Steve.
Facing unbeatable odds, the Falcons dive toward Artis 5. The Verbal tanks, invincible, began sweeping the Falcons from their runs. 200 died in the initial attack. Undaunted, the sacrifice of the Falcon pilots enabled the Saber flight to penetrate the Verbal tank defense lines. But as the groups got lower into the atmosphere, a deadly twist awaited them.
Cross ships, oh mama.
Steve, dive around them.
Where are they hot? Lost Adams and Jenny.
Tuck it in, Dave. Tighten it.
Imps of space, there went Johnson.
What's the deal? Cross ships have never been that good.
They're manned by helitoids. This is too much. We'll never win.
Brad, get a hold of yourself. We've got to keep at it.
Tick right, Steve. You've got two on your tail.
Breaking right. Oh, rats.
You're hit, Steve.
Oh, rats.
Steve, can you get out?
No, I've lost induction. Blowers are gone. Oh, rats, that blasted lizard knew right where to hit me. Get out of here, Dave. Try and find the target.
You're a good flyer, David.
Sure. I drew a map for the helitoid to follow. Take care, Dave.
Still got some control. Wonder if I can get her down somewhere. Where? There. On that plane. If I can just miss that Empire ground station. Come on. Come on! Lateral boost. RCS off. Oh, rats! Gear won't lower. I'll have to belly it in.
Slowly, Steve Davis brought the wounded Falcon in for a bumpy landing. As the burning fighter ground to a halt, Steve blew the canopy and leapt from the ship and dived for cover before it exploded.
Just make it undercover. Uh-oh. Hover sleds. They must have seen me come down. I can't get caught.
Put your hands up, Flyboy, and drop your blaster, or this Centron droid will ruin your day. Thought your pitiful resistance could stop Lord Echion, did it? Well, too bad. Let's see who you are. Smart. No ID. Okay, let's see what your genetics say. 624, genetic scan. Matrix. Imps. I've got Steve Davis. Well, too bad for you. This'll wrap up your career. Come on. We're sending you to New Andralia. Sergeant, call headquarters. His Royal Eminence will be pleased to hear who I've captured.
The news of Steve Davis' capture and the destruction of the once proud Eagle Squadron flowed through the Resistance like water. On New Andralia, the news was met with rejoicing as Baman of Welter summoned Jangal of the Arcs of Herd to his plush mountaintop residence.
Enter, Jangal.
Your Eminence,
I come bringing good news.
And it is true.
Indeed, Excellency. Artus V was attacked by a force of 200 Star Command fighters. Evidently all that was left of the original Eagle Squadron.
And?
We have a complete victory. Only 10 Falcons escaped. We have also captured Steve Davis.
Wonderful! At last! We have another of General Arramus' remaining inner circle of pilots. Now maybe we can discover Pleiades' hiding place.
How? No one has ever been able to locate Pleiades.
I know that, but in a day or two, we'll put Davis and Arramus together in a surveillance cell. Surely, old friends will have much to discuss, maybe even a clue to Pleiades' whereabouts.
Oh, I see. Oh, Excellency, Echion returns tonight.
The fool! He's obsessed with his portals. He spends his time modifying the Magellanic Array from deep space tracking to portal generation, hoping to find his primeval portal planet, Focus 7, and his trips the Black Dragon manpower to do it.
But, Excellency, we need the portals too.
I know that, but his preoccupation with it is unnerving. It's as if he's still trying to defeat his Dawn-era enemy.
Von Mestre?
Yes. It is true Mestre left a photo message to the so-called Warriors of Light on Riker, but his existence is impossible. Outside of a Dyson blister, he could not survive for 5 billion years.
Yet the stories continue to circulate about the Fox brothers being alive.
Oh, curse them, Jangal. Am I to be hounded eternally by their memory? They are dead. Their atoms lie scattered in some gravitational eddy, parsecs from nowhere. Oh, come, Jangal. We'll see to Major Davis' incarceration.
But Mike and Ken were far from dead, although they were indeed parsecs away. Not since the Dawn era had the Bellatrix flown in space. Yet now, Varn Mestre's magnificent shuttle sped at hyperlight speed toward the galaxy of the Vanguards. Inside, Mike sat pensively on the bridge, contemplating the saga that he and his brother were engaged in. Ken joined him.
Mike?
Oh, hi, Ken.
You okay?
Yeah. Look at that galaxy, Ken. It was nothing more than a tiny speck on our Star Command star charts. And now it's less than 2 months away. This whole thing is incredible.
I know. Every time I walk onto this bridge, I have to remember that this technology is 5 billion years old.
Yeah, and look at this bubble we're under. Totally transparent with updates and course data appearing on it. Our guys have nothing like this.
Varn Mestre. I'd really like to meet this guy.
I wonder if he's still alive.
Mogor said nothing concrete about that possibility.
Dear old Mogor. I miss him.
Why didn't he come with us?
He looked pretty beat when we left Coca Beam.
Was he sick?
Well, after that ride into the Harboris black hole, I'm surprised we're still here.
How old would you say Mogor is?
Hard to say. 80, 85?
He never told us. He just seemed eternal. You know, like he'd live forever. Boy, that galaxy is beautiful. You say we're still 2 months from it?
Yeah. At least that's what 74D calculated.
Did he finally figure out how to talk to the ship's computer?
Him? Are you kidding? He said 361 told him.
361, but he hasn't peeped since we boarded 5 months ago.
I know, but he says 361 talks to him all the time. If you ask me, his scanners are flaking out.
Shh, here he comes.
Good day, sirs. I find it so invigorating to communicate freely with you now, using the new intelligibility programming and atonal modifications given me of Oreb on Kokal Beam. And I never tire of the view from this Mangrum observation bubble.
Mangrum bubble?
Yes, Master Michael. A development of early Mestrate science. From the outside, it is opaque, unless you are in a Vanguard, at which time the bubble is transparent. But it is transparent from within, no matter what kind of spacecraft.
Hey, wait a minute, Bolt Bucket. Where did you get this Mangrum bubble jazz?
It was imparted digitally by infrared osmotic convection, utilizing cybernetic wavelength induction from my counterpart.
What?
361 told him.
Then why didn't he just say that?
To have downgraded the significance of the new communicative skills employed by 361.
Oh, forget it. I shouldn't have dropped the lingo chips on the Benevolent.
Brr.
What's wrong?
Do you feel that?
Imps of space, chills.
Is something amiss?
No, it's like an icy hand reached in and grabbed my soul.
Temperature's okay. D-scan to outside. Any radiation of any type?
No, sir. But I detect a huge disturbance in the lower radio frequencies, middle scan quadrant.
How far?
About 3 parsecs.
Parsecs? Is what we feel coming 3 parsecs?
Unknown, sir. But there are no other disturbances within light centuries.
Measurements? Composition?
A nebula, about 6 AU across.
Imps of space, what is it?
Unknown energy source. The nebula is totally without light.
Hey, Mike, maybe the Unitranser with the eyes that see would help.
Good idea. Wait here.
Mike left the bridge and hurried through the Bellatrix to a special storage area to retrieve the Unitranser with the eyes that see, marvelous implements of the Dawn era with special powers, given them by Mogor and Oreb, the guardian of the City of Light. Michael took them and returned to the bridge, unaware that 361 quietly followed behind him.
Here, Ken, be careful with them.
Well, they sure are different looking things.
Adjust the eyepieces. Let's see, can you see anything?
Barely. Wait a minute. The image is getting clearer. Imps of space.
Did you see something?
Look at that.
Ken, help me adjust mine. Great era. What is that?
It looks like a planet, but its size.
74D, can you plot the mass behind the nebula?
There is no mass behind the nebula, Master Michael.
What do you mean, no mass? It's got to be almost 70,000 kilometers across.
I reiterate, Master Michael, my scanners show only a dense nebula with obfuscating elements emitting unknown low-frequency radiation.
Mike, he's right. The outline of the nebula is graphically superimposed over the planet. It is absolutely huge. Something that large should be unstable, but why can't 74D see it?
Because 74D is looking only at empirical measurements. The planet you see exists in hyperspace and can only be discerned with the eyes that see.
361, you spoke!
361, you did speak.
Indeed, Master Michael. My capabilities and communicative abilities were restored by Mogor and Oreb on Kokalbeam.
Restored? What do you mean, restored?
It is not possible to relate all the circumstances regarding my previous silence at this time. Your most immediate task is to activate the Procyon, the 13th Vanguard.
361, is that a planet?
It is Focus 7, a world constructed by Echion, the Dark Lord in the Dawn era.
The same Echion that was imprisoned in the Harborus Dyson blister?
Yes. This world is the Master Portal Station, a relay world built to assist and amplify source portals throughout the universe. All portal transmissions of a transgalactic nature converge through and are amplified on this world.
Mike, look. I see lights. Cities.
No, they are power units that have been activated by Echion from the Magellanic Array in the Persepolian sector of your galaxy. Echion has reactivated the world to transport helitoids back to Mhyrn to destroy the 13th Vanguard before you reach it. He will arrive there soon.
Is there any way to stop him?
Indeed, but the danger is great. Many unknowns await on Focus 7. It is imperative that you intervene.
How?
You must travel to Focus 7.
How can we? It's in hyperspace.
The Phantom Mode. The ships of light can take us there.
Ken, you still haven't told me about the Phantom Mode.
361, what can we do when we get there?
It will take all your sacred implements. The Buckler of Wings, the Unitranser, the Mestrate Disruptor, myself, courage, and the power of the Creator to protect you against the evils that reside on that world. Now we must move swiftly.
All right. Ken, get the ships of light ready. I'll load the artifacts in 361.
The ships of light left the Bellatrix and slipped into the Phantom Mode, entering hyperspace and the dimension of Focus 7, which now stretched out of sight on either side of them. 361, the little droid turned mentor, directed them into the malevolent darkness that was Focus 7. Soon, a gothic form materialized out of the gloom, and the Warriors of Light headed for and landed on a huge stone outcropping, which was below a huge fortress of metal. Here, the source of the flickering light bathed the ships in an eerie glow. Mike opened his canopy.
Imps of space, we're in hell.
It is imperative that you never physically step upon this ground. Use the Buckler of Wings for all your movements.
You got that Mestrate Disruptor? Remember, it'll destroy anything.
Glued to my hand.
Ooh, 361, what is this place?
This is the Fortress of Herd. When Focus 7 was in its prime, Echion himself resided here.
Ooh, boy, the spirit in this place is pure blackness. 361, what must we do?
We are to penetrate this fortress and discover the extent of Echion's reactivation progress. We must also beware of the imps.
Imps?
Genetic mutations of helotoid experiments in the Dawn era.
Ooh, boy, I hope they're all dead.
They, like the helotoids, were fearsome creatures. Now, activate your flying belts.
It feels like an anti-grav simulator.
Activate your porta strobes, for once we enter the fortress, there will be little or no light. I will activate my anti-grav lifters and follow you.
I didn't know you could do that.
Let us begin.
Carefully, the landing party entered the ancient fortress on Focus 7. Inside, the group floated gently along the dingy black corridors, their porta strobes enveloping them in a ball of light. Using their unitransers, the boys peered into the gloom and saw macabre decorations and other details hidden from their natural eyes. As they rounded a bend in the passageway, Mike felt a presence.
Hold it. Ken?
Do you feel that? I do. 361, we've got to get out of here now.
It is the evil of Echion.
Definitely black arts. What do you see with the Unitranser?
Ooh, nothing but a corridor leading into total blackness.
This is the access to the heart of Focus 7. We must proceed.
Hold it. Not in your life. Come on, Ken.
Right behind you.
Brethren, wait. You cannot leave now. This is the control center for Focus 7. We must see the extent of the activation. What you feel is the very essence of evil itself. Remember, your armor and your implements will shield you from everything except your own fears, and you must deal with that yourself. Follow your hearts and take courage.
You're right. Sorry. Everybody fears something.
Yeah, dark basements has been ours. Come on, Mike. You go first.
I wish Dad would turn the light on for us.
Deeper into the sinister fortress they traveled, watching through the amazing unitransers. Shortly, the flickering light became brighter, and Mike, Ken, and 361 floated into an enormous cavern. Conduits and black openings surrounded them. A hot, foul wind blew as they floated in the blue light. The threesome huddled together.
Whew! What place is this?
This is one of Echion's portal relay chambers. There are some 50,000 chambers like this one in other areas of the planet. All transgalactic matter transmissions relay through one of these chambers. It is this very chamber that Echion plans to use to send his armies to Mhyrn.
361, how do you know all this? It's incredible.
The Mestrate records are extremely detailed. Mogor and Orev were able to implant all of it in my memory.
Yeah, but how do you know he'll use this chamber?
Because this is the portal to Mhyrn.
What? You're joking!
It is true. The blue light that we see flickering indicates that Echion has indeed remotely activated the Corollers. They are the power units that caused the warp itself.
You're saying that this portal is operational?
Yes. He will begin sending troops as soon as he can build up enough power to transmit the armies.
So as soon as Echion fires up the Magellanic Array again, he can send his troops and helotoids here, and then on to Mhyrn?
That is correct.
Why don't we go through the portal to Mhyrn first? It would get us there in enough time to find the Procyon. And you obviously know how to operate the portal from here. Why not go?
It is true I can activate the portal, but it is contrary to the Brotherhood of Light to use evil things for righteous purposes.
So, we just sit here and watch Echion send his helotoids to Mhyrn.
Sweet. 361, can we destroy the portal so they can't use it? We have the Mestrate Disruptor.
It is unwise, for there is no way of knowing what a Meson shockwave would do to the fabric of hyperspace after so many millennia. We must delay them another way.
Wait a minute. That's it. Delay!
Huh?
361, we can't use the portal. But do you know where the portal destination controls are?
Indeed. They would be in the Fortress Master Control Room.
Mike, what have you got up your sleeve?
Tell you later. Come on, 361, have you seen what you came for?
Unfortunately, I have.
Okay, then lead us to the control room.
Mike and Ken completed their secret task in the fortress control room and returned to the Bellatrix and the ships of light. As they entered the storage bay airlock, they were met by a frantic 7-4 Delta.
Boy, is it good to get out of there.
Master Michael, Master Ken.
What is it, Dee?
While you were gone, I had relegated myself to performing my basic maintenance tasks. As I was paralleling generators near the junction conduits, I experienced heavy mag flux ripples and some DC power bumps.
Will you tell us what's wrong?
The wall behind me slid open. It was full of instrumentation I could not comprehend.
The Chamber of Lights.
Chamber of Lights?
The proximity of the evil on Focus 7 has caused the Chamber of Lights to activate. In Varn Mestre's time, as the battle for the universe was underway, this compartment was his refuge. Here the implements of light were kept. Here Varn Mestre was able to view the progress of the conflict. It was here that he tricked Echion into the Dyson blister. From here, with the Unitranser, he could see all things.
361, is it permissible for us to see the chamber?
It is not only permissible, but imperative, for there are things you both must see.
They hurried through the ship and entered reverently into a crystalline room reminiscent of the City of Light. Obviously a control center, the brothers looked dumbfounded at yet another wonder of technological superiority. Their attention was drawn to a large viewer, which was part of a large cube.
361, this place is such a contrast to Focus 7.
That is correct, Master Kenneth. It was truly a place of refuge for Varn Mestre, a strengthening, restoring, and holy place.
361, this view scope and panel are almost identical to the portal instrumentation on Focus 7.
That is true. It is, in fact, a small portal generator. Varn Mestre installed this unit, which is similar to Echion's generator, yet it works on a less disruptive principle than Echion's, while it has double the range.
What function does the viewscope play?
It can scan along the portal beam like a carrier wave, and allow us to see what's happening on the receiving end.
Do you mean that we could look back into our own galaxy?
Yes, and forward to Mestre's.
Mike, we could check on Mogor.
No, check on your commanding officer.
But we don't know where he is.
He is still held prisoner on Terran. He is in the old Federation prison and is being threatened at this moment by Baman.
361, how do you know all this?
Have faith, my masters. Remember, Mogor would have you help the unfortunate. All your questions will be answered in time.
So how do we use this device to see Arramus?
Sit at the console. Put on the headband and push the amber switch. Now the device will scan your brain and load all of the logistical data you have in your memory into the processor. It will use your alpha waves to address the portal beam, and will locate the spot you see in your mind's eye.
Wow.
Such technology is far beyond my capabilities.
Okay, I'm ready.
Proceed.
Great Hera, look how Terran has changed.
The swines, well. Look who's here.
Is that Baman? Look at him strut. Oh, that must be a helitoid. Ugly-looking things, aren't they?
Yeah. Look how much they resemble those imp skeletons we saw in Focus 7. Bayman's entering the cell block. I can't believe this! That viewer can see through walls, security fields, anything!
Mike, look! Steve Davis, Eddings, Justin. The whole gang is in prison. Imps of space, who's left on Pleiades?
There's General Arramus. Look how thin he is! Bayman's coming into his cell. 361, does this viewer have audio?
Yes. Press the flashing red button next to the amber switch.
So, Arramus, it's been many months since we visited. I trust the food is satisfactory, the accommodations adequate.
What do you want, Baman?
Your cooperation.
Go on.
I want the location of the Pleiades.
How did he find out about Pleiades?
Shh. Baman, you must be getting old.
I think that was meant to be an insult.
Call it what you like. How can I give you something I don't have?
Oh, how I tire of this outdated heroic martyr complex that you military men hold on to. Do you think us daft? Do you think by hiding your heads in the sand that others cannot see the rest of you? We have known of Pleiades' existence since the fall of Terron. It's spoken of in hushed tones by refugees and others. The people look to it as a form of divine salvation. It's unfortunate that they feel this way, as it causes resistance to our causes.
Oh, you're breaking my heart.
Listen to me, soldier boy. Your pilots attacked Artis 5 and tried to destroy the plant where the portal core fittings are made. It failed. We claimed 200 Falcons destroyed. The rest of your Eagle squadron. We even captured Major Davis, who shares the cell block with you. You don't have any more Falcons. But we need to destroy what there are. We can't have any more delays, and we must break the back of the Resistance.
Listen, Baman. I don't know how dumb you think I am. Even if there was a Pleiades, I wouldn't tell you. You can eat stale biscuits.
All right, Arramus. I have grown weary of you. I thought we could discuss this calmly, and maybe you save lives by telling us Pleiades' location. Now, that time of gentle questioning is over. If I don't have the location of Pleiades by noon tomorrow, I will send the verbal fleet to destroy the neutral worlds. For every day of delay, another world will be destroyed, and we will execute one of your pilots.
Baman, how can that depraved mind of yours generate enough power to keep you breathing? You can't destroy the neutral worlds. Your worries would triple. Do you know what the repercussions would be among the satellite planets?
I don't care. We would crush any uprisings. But I tell you again, Arramus, I want results. You've heard my order. I want the location of Pleiades by noon tomorrow. One star system a day will die, along with one of your hot pilots. They will die in your name, and we will begin with Canopus 3.
Someday, Baman, I swear your empire of evil's gone far enough. The Creator won't allow you free reign forever. Somewhere the ships of light are waiting to deliver us.
You will eat those words.
Until noon. Guard, take me out of here. I wonder what the Resistance will say when I tell them that their exalted General Arramus has capitulated and ordered the destruction of the neutral worlds.
Get out. Get out of here, you swine.
Farewell, Arramus.
What has been going on?
Mike, poor Arramus, the neutral worlds. Those are the worlds of great artistic peoples, hospitals, research centers. Have we sunk that low? Has mankind finally done it? What can we do out here?
361, I want to open a portal to Arramus's cell.
Is that your solution?
Yes.
Wait, what solution?
I'm going to take the Mestrate disruptor to Arramus.
It was late in the evening. General Arramus sat gloomily in his cell in the Federation prison on Terran, which Baman had renamed New Andralia. He wiped his eyes in despair. Should he reveal Pleiades' location? If he told Baman the location of the secret asteroid base, then Baman would destroy the last chance to fight against the Empire. If he didn't tell them, millions in the innocent neutral worlds, yet untouched by the Empire, would perish. He tossed in his chair, and then threw himself on the cot. As he lay there, he saw a peculiar glow. Where was that light coming from? As he sat up, a strange noise filled the cell. Arramus' mouth opened wide as a friendly form stepped out of a tear in the wall.
Hello, General.
Mike? Mike Fox?
It's been a long time.
But how? How did you find me in here? How did you get here?
It's part of Mestrate's science. There isn't time to explain.
Well, where's Ken and the ships of light?
I can't tell you everything now, but Ken is fine.
Mike, do you know what's happening?
Yes, we saw Baman as he spoke to you. We're aware of Echion's plans, but Ken and I can't intervene right now. We're involved in another aspect of the battle. But I assure you, Star Command and goodness will triumph.
But how can we stop them? How did you get here?
A small Mestrate portal. But that's unimportant. I brought you a friend, an ally.
Huh?
Take this.
What is it? It looks like a blaster.
It is. But it's not a standard Star Command issue. It's an Acrucian blaster, a Mestrate disruptor.
Acrucian blaster?
Yes, it'll destroy anything.
Anything?
Anything. In fact, you could begin by using it to get out of this cell.
Yes. Then I could get away to Denbar.
Take Davis and the other guys with you. Davis can fly a cross ship.
I can't believe this is actually happening. Wait a minute. How do I know this isn't a photoplasmic image? One of Baman's tricks.
It isn't. Someday we'll explain. Just thank the Creator that there's still men who care for each other.
Will we see you again? We're gonna need more pilots.
You'll see us. But now I must return and continue our mission. The blaster should give the Empire a long-needed rest from its reign of terror. Good luck, General. Say hello to Steve and Dave for me. Tell Steve to watch out for ion inductors.
Bless you, too. This is the first tangible hope we've had in 3.5 years. Take care.
Same to you.
General Arramus sat in stunned silence as the magnitude of what happened sunk in. Was it real? It was, for the mighty blaster lay on his cot glistening in the moonlight. He sat, and then resolved, he gathered himself up, reached for the blaster, and began.
Okay. Well, I guess we ought to try this. Maybe I'll see if they want to eat some stale biscuits. Now hear this! All swine will return to their pens! Imps of space! That really works! Davis! Steve Davis!
Here. General? Is that you?
Uh-oh. Helitoids. Hey, lizards! Over here! Hello, Captain. I mean, Major. How are things?
Fine, I guess. Look out!
Holy Hannah! Isn't this something? Stand back! Come on. Let's get Justin and the rest.
The Terran prison rocked with explosions as one by one the remaining pilots of the Eagle Squadron were freed. Commandeering a hovercraft, the escapees raced to the spaceport. The hovercraft banked over the bunkers and headed for a small armed transport and landed, disgorging a now well-armed band of Star Command Patriots.
Justin, fire up that transport!
You got it, General.
Davis, can you still fly a Kroz escort fighter?
Yeah, I think so. Well, how did you know?
Mike told me. Get going.
Mike? Mike Fox?
I'll explain later.
Attention! Attention! You cannot escape! Surrender! Lay down your arms!
I've had enough of that mentality.
Where did you get that blaster? Criminy!
Major Davis, will you get your body into that cross ship and fly cover?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir!
Baman!
Wherever you are, I hope you hear about this escape, and I hope you worry about it a lot. Star Command lives. Let's go!
As Arramus and the remnants of Star Command fled to Denbar, Baman sat quietly, unaware of the escape. A tone sounded.
Who's there?
Excellency, it is I, Jangal.
Oh, enter. Why are you late? I need to depart for the prison. Has Echion arrived? Well, speak, man.
Excellency, Arramus has escaped.
What?
Just moments ago from the spaceport.
You lie! The helitoids would have stopped them.
No, Excellency. Arramus had a blaster. It vaporized the helitoids. All of the Star Command pilots were rescued. Nobody could stop them.
No! No! What imbecile gave Arramus a blaster?
No one knows. He just blasted out of his cell.
It is impossible. Jangal, you lie. You lie!
No, Baman, look! The fire from the spaceport. Call spaceport security yourself.
This cannot be. Where did they go?
Tracking said they were headed for Denbar.
You! Get the tank! Get Ober! Find them! Destroy Denbar if need be. I want them back, do you hear? Dead or alive, I want them back! Nothing can stop a verbal tank.
But, Excellency, the helitoids were invincible, too. Yet they were vaporized. Just vaporized!
The helitoids were not made of hydrosteel. Now send for Ober. I want that tank now. This instant. Do you hear? This instant!
Yes, Excellency.
And on Denbar, Arramus sat talking with an ecstatic Colonel Reeber.
And then Mike Fox appeared in a small portal opening?
Yes, right out of the wall. And then he handed me this blaster. I still can't believe it. But now I know both he and Ken survived the black hole in Harborus, and they still have the ships of light. It is incredible.
I've got a million questions. This blaster, its technology is absolutely implausible. I know.
And we'll answer that later, but can we get back to Pleiades?
Yeah. Okay. The channel is still open, but it won't be easy. The Empire's doubled all back spaceway patrols looking for us.
What about Falcons?
Only 20 or so left, and of them, only 10 are flyable, maybe 7 combat ready. It's pretty grim.
Brother. Well, we fought with less.
You say this blaster vaporized helitoids?
Yeah. They just turned bright blue and vanished in a puff of smoke.
General, trouble.
That's a Verbil tank. They found us already?
Come on, let's get outside. Steve, get everybody down and undercover.
Yes, sir.
General, do you think that will stop the tank?
We're about to find out.
Look out, Black Dragon troops.
Baman, wherever you are, I hope you hear this too.
Good grief! Imps of space, there it goes! Davis, there it goes!
Never thought I'd see this. The destruction of a Verbil tank.
This Acrucian blaster is unbelievable. Even hydrosteel is no match for it.
Baman's gonna have a bad day.
Gentlemen, we have to get to Pleiades. Word will travel fast, and we can't endanger the people of Denbar by staying here. Come on, let's go.
It was dark now, The lights in the Palace of Echion and Baman blazed brilliantly. A legion of helotoids stood guard nervously. Echion had returned from the Magellanic Array. As his followers and bodyguards cleared the entryway, onlookers gazed in amazement as Echion disembarked. For this was not the old Echion of the first portal, but a young man, as suave as he was deadly. The crowd began to talk among themselves.
No, that isn't Echion. Echion's an old man. I saw him when the first portal opened years ago.
Yes, it is he. He used the black arts to return to his real self. The old man was one of his disguises.
Oh.
It is said he can appear in many forms.
Well, I, for one, would like to see him gone.
Silence! Do you want to get us killed? He comes by us now.
Echion strode past the crowd and into the palace where he was met by Baman's Prime Minister, Jangal.
Your Eminence, welcome back.
You are surprisingly cordial. Where is your master?
You are my master.
Don't patronize me, Jangal. Where is Baman?
He awaits you in the antechamber.
Mand, data nobis cum volit. Come with me, Jangal.
I obey your Eminence.
Echion, dear friend, welcome back. Will you have some Saurian nectar?
Spare me your gratuitous amenities. I want answers.
Answers?
General Arramus escaped with part of the Equal Squadron. The prison in shambles and helotoids destroyed.
I do not know how Arramus escaped. We know that he stole a shuttle and fled. I sent the Bellerophon with my own personal commander to Denbar to capture Arramus or destroy the planet. I'm waiting word even now. Whatever happened, we will never know. And with Arramus dead, the resistance will falter and we don't need to know the whereabouts of Pleiades.
But Denbar is still in orbit.
Then? Ober captured Arramus and is returning home with the captives. And we shall pick up where we left off. I think I shall recommend Ober for a gallantry cross.
Yes, we will give it to him posthumously.
Posthumously?
Fool! Arramus destroyed your verbal tank with an Acrucian blaster. It is the only thing that can destroy a helotoid.
What? Destroyed? But that's impossible. Hydrosteel is invincible. It cannot be.
Imbecile! You forget what you learned on Riker. An Acrucian blaster is of the Mestrates. It can destroy anything, including your so-called invincible tanks.
My poor Albert.
Somehow, Arramus got a hold of the blaster. The Fox brothers. They did it. They're the only ones who would have access to the Mestrate antiquities. Of course. Mestre's portal on the Bellatrix. So, it happens again. We must activate the Magellanic Array.
But the Fox brothers are dead! I myself saw them fly into the Harborus black hole. They couldn't have survived.
It is obvious that you do not know as much about Mestrate science as you claim to. You must realize the Fox brothers are the warriors of light. They have the Bellatrix, and if we don't move to stop them now, they will have us. Mand. Kolor Volkron Trego. You see, my naive Baman. With an Acrucian blaster loose, Arramus will most assuredly attack the Magellanic Array. But it will not be. You see, I have an ancient device, which we developed while imprisoned in the Dyson blister, which will protect the tanks from the rays of the blast. Unfortunately, it won't stop the Bellatrix, since its distance is too far away. We must leave immediately for the Array and send the Invincibles to Mhyrn. There can be no more delay.
But Arramus is still loose.
Will you forget your personal hate for Star Command? They are nothing. You worry about trivial things. Don't you realize that the Black Arts are more powerful than a puny detachment of overstimulated soldiers?
But they...
Silence! Prepare your things. We leave tomorrow.
Echion moves swiftly, returning to the Magellanic Array to complete his plans to teleport his crack helitoid commandos to Focus 7 and then on to Mhyrn. As the Magellanic Array crackled into life, 50,000 fully armed soldiers crowded into the ancient portal chamber. Echion, the Dragon of Night, was overjoyed as he mounted an ancient platform to address his reptilian soldiers. Thousands cheered as their leader raised his arms for quiet.
My glorious sons, our trip from the Magellanic Array to this portal chamber on Focus 7 has been successful. It is an omen of our future victory. For eons, we have awaited this moment to even the score with the Mestrates. No longer will we wait in the cursed Dyson blister as goodness triumphs. We are powerful, invincible, unconquerable. Now, my sons, prepare yourselves. Unleash the black arts. Create mayhem. Show no mercy. Prepare to call upon the black dragon. Call forth the end star. Even prosix that all may be in ruin. That the billion fleets may come through and claim another universe. Destroy the Vanguard. Grind it to atoms. Cause that its memory may fade from mankind. Destroy! 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 Now, my sons, prepare to enter the portal for the trip to Mhyrn.
Phalanx upon phalanx lined up at the cavern end of the massive portal as Echion energized the corridors. As he did so, Manned, his chief helitoid, approached with a concern.
Master, it has been eons since we left Focus 7. Should ye not verify the Mhyrnese coordinates?
No, my son. No living thing has set foot upon this world of destiny. No living being has violated its surface. For if they had, the imps would have regenerated and vanquished them.
What of the light one?
Not even they can withstand the power of the black arts upon this surface. No, Mand. There is no need to fear. Now, it is time to activate the portal's Chiron transmitters. Come, we will go together.
Echion approached the portal controls and energized the Mhyrnese portal. As the portal opened, the helitoids moved into the corridor. A brilliant light illuminated the hall. Tongues of white heat hurtled into the portal, vaporizing the helitoids and setting fire to the generators. Echion recoiled in horror.
No! No! The coordinates have been changed. Matt, close the portal. I set my helitoids into the center of a sun. Close it. No!
Death, destruction, mayhem. I can't take it anymore.
Everything we knew has changed. Nothing is the same anymore. What happened to the helitoids?
When we were on Focus 7, I changed the Mhyrnese coordinates. Instead of arriving on Mhyrn, they materialized inside a sun.
But Mike, you had to do it.
I know, but I'm tired of evil and there's so much left to do.
Yes, but Echion is dead. Focus 7 is at best disabled, and the helitoids have been stopped. That will give us more time.
Perhaps. I worry about the balance. I worry that Echion or his influence will deal us a curve. There's still Baman to worry about. He knows what we know, and the only difference between him and Echion is that he's dumber.
I'm really not sure about Echion.
Come on, Mike. How could he survive the center of a sun?
Well, how did he survive 4 billion years in a black hole? We're not out of this yet.
Do you think there'll ever be peace in the universe?
Only the Creator knows, Ken. Come on. Let's get to Mhyrn. We still have to activate the Vanguard, and Baman isn't going to take up knitting.
Mike and Ken of Star Command has been a TriFox production. Starring Ron McKean as Mike and Brad Nygren as Ken. Baman was played by Lynn McKinnley. Jangal by Bob Pusey. Reuben Fox played Steve Davis. Scott Swofford played Dave Gray. Mike Van Dorn was Major Reeber. General Arramus was played by Orval Fox Jr. Donna Johnson was General Lucian. Echion was played by Perry Coe. Others included Quinn Orr, Wayne Christiansen, Lewisine Fox, and Joan Fox. This is Mark Van Wagoner speaking. Don't miss Episode 5, The Eye of Polyphemus, of Mike and Ken of Star Command. Story copyright 1986 by the TriFox Brain Trust Group.